Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to AVO's webinar series. Today's topic is substations, looking from outside in. My name is Michael Pike. I'm the Marketing Communications Specialist for AVO Training Institute, and I'll be your moderator for today's presentation and supporting you on technical issues and questions for our presenter. On the right side of your screen, you'll see a control panel that looks similar to this one. You can submit questions at any time during the presentation by typing in the box highlighted in red, and I'll read the questions out during the Q&A segment at the end of the webinar. All attendees will be eligible to receive one NITA CTD and one professional development hour. You will receive your attendance confirmation in an email within 2 business days after the webinar. That email will also include a copy of the PowerPoint presentation and a link to the recorded video of the webinar if you would like to watch it again or share it with colleagues. Remember, you can ask questions at any time during the presentation, and they will be answered after the webinar ends. Our presenter for today is Greg Richmond, AVO Training Specialist. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Thank you for joining us, Greg.
All right. Thanks, Mike. I appreciate the chance to do these webinars. They're good. They give me a good opportunity to interact with the real technicians out there. You know, keep in mind, this is our second webinar on substations, and these are very generic and open-ended when it comes to substations. We could talk for weeks and weeks about all the components with substations and so forth. So I really do get it. I enjoy getting a chance to talk about this and kind of spreading a little bit of wealth and knowledge and across my brotherhood, because that's what it's really all about, is sharing information. That's what we're in the business for. So we've got a second look at substation components and their functions. Of course, for the first one we talked about was going to be everything from generating all the way down to sub-transmission, transmission, distribution, and our residential type. So now we're going to talk about involvement with power once it's delivered from the generation station to transmission, sub-transmission, and industrial and distribution type stations. So this is our itinerary for the afternoon here. We're going to give a small review over the first substation webinar, just a little one, just to kind of recap things we talked about before. We'll talk basically about, then we'll dip right into what we're going to be talking about for the next few minutes as far as a substation layout. We're going to, the basic substation layout is I'm going to give you 6 different types of layouts and their pros and cons, do's and don'ts, and so forth. Then we'll talk about conductors within a substation. Obviously, the 2 main types of conductors are going to be our aluminum and copper type conductors. Talk about different bus bars. Various types of switches is another one we'll bring up. Surge arrestors is another one, and the important role that they play within the substation world as well. Battery maintenance, that seems to be everybody's favorite, of course. We'll get a little bit into battery maintenance, talk about some basic tests to run with battery maintenance. That's another issue we could probably go on for days about, is batteries within the substation, how to maintain them. Capacitor banks is another one we'll talk about, and what type of a role that they play within substations as well. Transitions, okay, I believe that these are important because they give people a good perspective on how that type of conductor rolls in and out of that type of substation, along with terminations, of course, with transitions. One of the most important things, of course, is going to be importance with one-line diagrams, how to follow those one-line diagrams and what they're used for within the substation. And lastly, one of the last ones is the down and dirty with testing. So like all subjects, and I think I may have said this a couple times already, is that with down and dirty with testing, we can go for days talking about testing. Each component's going to get their own separate type of tests. We're not going to get into that or anything, but we are going to talk directly about different avenues that you can go forth as far as getting testing done and frequency within that substation as far as testing is concerned. Lastly, safety is obviously going to be something that's going to be an extreme role when it comes to substation, making sure that the safety is followed like it's supposed to. We'll touch on some subjects, and obviously these subjects are going to be different from the last substation webinar we did. All right, so just a recap of what we talked about last webinar. I think it was last year sometime, late last year, but either way, We went over some of the types of generating systems out there in the field that you could see, as far as a nuclear type, a fossil type, a hydro, wind and solar type substations. We definitely talked about the different types of potential that we could run across as far as step and touch potential within a substation. Recognizing those different types of potentials as well is important. Making sure that that we understand those different types of potentials and how to mitigate shock with the technician as far as step and touch potential is concerned. Substation grounding grid was another issue we brought up. I brought up a couple of standards with this one here as far as IEEE standard with conductors and connections within. The IEEE standard, it's displayed on the slideshow as far as the application and testing with testing of your grounding grid as well. Like I said earlier, we talked about the different types of substations that you could see in the field as far as your transmission, sub-transmission, distribution, residential, just to name a couple of them. We got into a little bit about transformers, step up and step down type transformer. I think that there's going to be some webinars that are going to be done on transformers later on down the line, but we talked about the role of a transformer within a substation, circuit breakers and the different mediums involved with air, oil, vacuum, and SF6 as far as extinguishing that arc and cooling that arc if need be. Instrument transformers, CTs and PTs, we talked about what their purpose in life was for the substation. And switchgear, a little bit on switchgear. And then, of course, safety within the substation was another issue, of course, lastly. We can't ever not have a discussion about substation without discussing safety itself. So, all right. So let's get into it here. So we're going to briefly talk about. We've got seven different types of systems up there on the board that we can talk about. Typical substation layout is what we're going to be discussing. So I've got a single bus system, a single section bus system, double bus system, double breaker bus system. Okay, those two single section and single bus are going to work together along with the double breaker and double bus system. Our 1.5 bus system, we come up with a transfer bus system, and then lastly is going to be that ring type system. All right, obviously we know that there's going to be all kinds of different types of substation layouts out there based on different reasons. Okay, number one, first and foremost, is going to be that type of system voltage that may be needed for that substation. Okay, what is that substation's purpose in life going to be? Position of the substation is going to be another one. What type of elements, what type of climatic situations is that substation going to be exposed to as far as making sure that it lasts as long as it needs to last? Flexibility within the system is important. All right, and then lastly, of course, among others, is going to be the cost of the substation. How much is it going to cost to build that up where it's supposed to be? Some of the considerations whenever we're building substations or determining where we want to build a substation is to make sure that we build a simple substation, an area, a station where it's going to achieve what we need it to achieve and complete the mission like it's supposed to be done. Ease of maintenance, of course. We want to make that technician out there who's performing maintenance on that substation, we want to make his job as easy as possible for us so we can minimize any type of outage, power outage, and for the customer, who is our end goal to satisfy, of course. And lastly, or one of the last ones is going to be future growth, making sure that that substation is going to be able to allow us to put future expansion on that substation based on the amount of people that's going to be influx on that particular system, whether it be in a city or in a residential neighborhood or whatever it could be. All right. Ultimately, at the end of the day, though, making sure that this substation system is going to give us a maximum return on our product for what it needs to be done. All right. Single bus system. Okay. This is the most simplest type system. It's cheap and it's easy to design. All right, it's cost effective, it's convenient to operate, okay, it's simple in design. Like I said, all of the system, the entire system, all the feeders are going to be fed off of a single bus system. Obviously, one of our issues is going to be with this type of system is that maintenance is going to be an issue, because once that bus goes down, the entire system is going to go down. Okay. Simple, easy, effective. There's really not a lot going on to it. You can see the circuit breakers that are involved. I'll go ahead and go over these components real quick. We've got circuit breakers recognized as the squares. These isolator switches are error type switches that are going to be in line with our circuit breakers. CTs in line. And then, of course, we've got transformers that are going to be down here on the bottom. Of course, you could have different components attached to these different systems, not limited to what's exposed on the slideshow itself. Okay. Our single section bus system, okay, a little more advanced than a single bus type system, due to its sectionalizing circuit breaker that's involved. That's this little guy right here, okay. The isolation and back feed is an advantage with this type of system. It's similar to this single bus system. It's a little convenient. All right, some of the advantages with this type of system is all loads can be fed by switching on the sectional circuit breaker or the bus coupler, which is what that center type of breaker is often recognized as. If one of the sections of the bus bar system is under maintenance, part of the substation can be fed from energizing other sections of the bus bar from a different location. Some of the disadvantages of this type of a system is that maintenance of equipment and of any bay cannot be possible without interrupting the feeder or transformer connected to that bay itself. All right, double bus system, a little bit more advanced than our single type systems. All right, a little bit more reliable. Obviously, we've got two feeders coming in. There are two identical bus bars are used in such a way that any outgoing or incoming feeder can be taken from any of the buses. All right, any of the buses. We could have in a multitude of different feeders coming off of these buses as well. So every feeder is connected to both of the buses in parallel through an individual isolator. So there's that bus coupler, that isolator breaker that's involved in line, and you can see directly how it's connected directly to that top bus and the second bus in order to refeed or reroute any type of systems that go down. The advantage of this double bus system is obviously that it increases the flexibility, the capability of the system. All right? It allows that system to be maintained a little bit more than that single bus system would. Disadvantages of the double bus system is it doesn't permit breaker maintenance without interruption. Okay, with the double bus breaker bus system, this one's similar to the double bus bar system type. Okay, we've still got two identical bus bars feeding in the incoming and outgoing feeders. Okay, or incoming feeders can be taken from any of the buses. So here we've still got our circuit breakers in line along with our isolator switches, and our feeders are coming out all right off of the middle of these feeder lines, which means that we have a little bit more flexibility than we would with the double bus type system. All right, with the now next one up on the list is our 1.5 type breaker systems. All right, this is an improvement from the double bus system. All right, meaning that saving in the number of circuit breakers being used. For every two circuits, only one spare breaker is being provided. So one thing that I think is an advantage of this system is that during any fault of any of the buses, the fault could be instantaneously cleared without interrupting any of the feeders. All right, since all the feeders continue to feed from the bus itself. How that's done here is we've got a main breaker down here on the bottom here. The only issue with that breaker down there is that it needs to be rated for the load of both of those feeders. In the event that one of these two feeders do go down coming off of the bus, that it's able to pick up that power like it's supposed to. A little more reliable, all right? A little more reliable as far as your transfer system, but either way, it is a little bit more expensive because now you have to purchase the third breaker and run it in line with the single bus coming in in order to join both of those other two feeders for added protection. All right, transfer bus type system. Okay, transfer bus system is an alternative to the bus system, to the double bus system. With this bus, every feeder line is directly connected through an isolator to a second bus called a transfer bus. All right, a little bit similar to our double bus system, but really ultimately at the end of the day, we have these secondary lines that come off of our transfer buses and our main buses. All right, so we can isolate that main bus and perform maintenance on these pieces of equipment in the middle. We also, along with the same basic setup of our transfer or double bus system, we also have a bus coupler in the middle that allows for connectability between the transfer and the main bus system there. All right, we've got the next one up is going to be our lastly is going to be our ring bus type system. This one here is disadvantages. This is impossible to extend for future use, obviously, because it's got a ring type setup. Okay, it does provide a double feed to each feeder circuit, opening one breaker under maintenance. Otherwise, it does not affect any supply to any type of feeder. Okay, it's a ring type, obviously, so you're able to backfeed any type of issues that may come up as far as serviceability or maintenance or anything like that. So, quick rundown on different types of systems you can see out there in the field as far as substations are concerned. All right, let's get into talk a little bit about conductors here. Brief rundown on conductors and so forth. So here we go. So ultimately, at the end of the day, these conductors are simple. Their job is to carry energy from one place to another, uninterrupted. Okay, which is going to be protected by our insulators as far as being attached to any type of metal structure or anything like that. Okay, some of the things that we need to make sure of as far as our conductors are concerned is the choice itself depends on cost and efficiency. How much is it going to cost based on a run, and how efficient is it going to be? Okay, we need to make sure that our conductors serve a purpose. Our purpose is going to be making sure that its electrical conductivity is going to be uninterrupted, and then it's able to perform its job flawlessly with no issues, obviously. High tensile strength and mechanical stress, okay, depending on different elements out there in the field we could come across, and all over the world are going to dictate different type of elements of destruction. Those conductors need to be able to withstand whatever type of elements are thrown up on it. Can't be heavy, all right? And another one's going to be that we want to make sure that this is going to be cheap, but effective as well without any, like I said, interruptions. All right, so solid, of course, conductors is always an option within your substations, meaning that you could have a aluminum type solid bar that's going to be a little more reliable as far as making sure that it's being withheld up with the elements and so forth. A lot of line slap involved. It's easy to maintain and so forth as far as aluminum solid bus bars are concerned. Stranded conductors is another one to consider. As far as efficiency is concerned, our copper and aluminum conductors are going to be two obvious approaches when it comes to the different types of conductors. We could use these conductors for different applications such as bus ducts, bus bars are some that we could think about. Different applications, different uses are all obviously going to be applied differently depending on the substation itself. Panel boards is another one, switch gear, and different type of phase buses. So with our conductors as far as aluminum conductors are concerned, some of the advantages with aluminum conductors over copper conductors primarily is going to be because of its weight. Aluminum conductor is going to be a third of the weight of copper. All right, it's going to be a lot less corrosive resistant. Going to be able to withstand the elements. All right. Iron oxide is an issue. Obviously, we want to make sure that it stays rust-free so that no issues come up with any breaks or anything. Dissipates heat. Our aluminum conductor dissipates heat rather rapidly and evenly as well. It's very strong and it's also lightweight. We're able to transport it. It doesn't put a lot of strain on our equipment inside of substations on poles or any type of metal or concrete structures or anything. It's easy to fabricate, meaning that we're able to
make it go wherever we want it to go, cut segments up if we need to, easy to maintain, along with fabrication is where we want to be. All right. Okay, got a slide up here on some insulator types up here that we could see out there in the field. All right, obviously this is just a small idea of what you could see out there, but we'll go over them anyways. Electrical insulators must be used in an electrical system to provide unwanted flow of current path to the earth from its supporting points, okay? We want this current to flow from point A to point B, and we want these insulators to make sure that that current or that voltage doesn't flow anywhere but where it needs to be, meaning our primary concern is going to be the ground. All right, so we need these insulators to be as reliable as possible. Three types of insulators run across out there is going to be our porcelain type, glass type, and polymer. When we're selecting insulators, there's a few things to consider. Okay, meaning that these insulators need to be mechanically strong. They need to be able to carry the current itself, but also to carry any type of the weight of the conductors. No issues need to be concerned with weight. We need to make sure we have that taken care of. Dielectric strength to take care of any type of voltage stresses is another one we need to think about. High insulation, possessing a high insulation, of course, lastly, it can't be porous. We don't need it to retain any water because clearly that's going to be an issue for our conductivity to ground. Okay, porcelain is normally used overhead type system. Glass has become more popular with transmission and distribution type systems. Glass, some of the advantage of glass is it has a high dielectric strength. All right, it also has a high resistivity, and it's has a higher tensile strength than compared to a porcelain type insulator as well. It doesn't get as hot as porcelain would be either. So glass is just one little option as far as insulators is concerned. It's also going to be cheaper than porcelain is as well. Okay, we get into polymer type insulators, just to kind of touch on those type of insulators you can see. They're lightweight, a whole lot lightweighter than glass and porcelain could be. Okay, their insulation has lower insulation is cheaper as far as cost is concerned. Okay, their performance is better in polluted areas, and there's less cleaning involved with polymer type insulators than there would be with glass and porcelain. I want to kind of touch on pin insulators real quick. Not a lot going on here, but are insulators in use? Okay, so just to kind of give you an idea about our insulators out there as far as glass type and our porcelain type, how they could be mounted to what's called an insulator pin, and the pin insulator is going to be on the insulator pin, which is going to separate that insulator from any type of structure, whether it be a concrete pole, wooden pole, steel pole, doesn't matter. That insulator pin is usually powered up to networks up to 33 kV, one part, two part, or three part, depending on the voltage application. Okay. A little more on insulators in use. Okay, this is a representation of a suspension type insulator for higher voltages beyond 33 kV. Becomes wasteful to use that pin insulator because of the size and weight. The cable itself becomes heavy, so this type of insulator, the suspension insulator, allows that insulator to work like it's supposed to without putting too much weight on the pole, and it suspends that cable like it's designed to do. The good part about this type of suspension insulator is that if any time along the way that any of these insulators get damaged, their ease of replacement is good there. All right, based on the amount of voltage that may be applied on that cable may be determined as far as how many of those insulators may be needed to be used in that system. Strain insulators, another one. This one's fairly simple. They're usually going to be used anytime there's a dead end or a sharp corner in a line. Okay, and the key here is tensile load with the strength. You can see the junction between both of those insulators from point A to point B as far as this little guy over here on the right hand side is concerned. Okay, usually used for transitions around corners and so forth. Simple construction. I like this slide right here. It shows on the left-hand column up here a rated system voltage, and in the middle there it talks about a number of disc insulators used, and I want to make sure I point this out in a strain type tension insulator string. And of course on the right-hand side it's going to show a number of disc insulators used in suspension insulator strings. So it really does a good job of kind of breaking down the different types of voltages, whether it be 33, 66, all the way up to 220, with the amount of insulators that may be needed for strain type and suspension type insulators. A little extra added information, I like to call it sprinkles on the cupcake. All right, so we'll dip into a little bit about switchers, okay, different types of switches. Within the substation, you could see these switches out in the field as well with your open air type gang operated switches. These here are open air type insulators. You could have an interrupter type switch that has a medium involved as far as a vacuum or an SF6 in order to help quench that arc. In this case here, air is the medium, so we could draw an arc. Okay, we want to try to mitigate that arc as much as possible. I do want to point out that this is this switch on the left-hand side here is a motorized grounding type switches. Okay, the one on the right over here is a gang operated type switch. All right, and when we start talking about surge arrestors, these picks over here on the right-hand side really does a good job of showing that type of surge protector for that switch. Okay. In the surge arrestors' sole purpose in life is to protect from any type of overvoltage. All right, any type of external or internal type of surges of voltage, we want to try to limit that. It's going to send that to ground before it ever even enters the equipment or structures or any type of substation. So this is our fail-safe, one of our fail-safes to limit any type of overvoltage. It's connected to the conductor before it goes into the equipment. That's its sole purpose. All right. Battery maintenance. Okay, used to control. These batteries are obviously going to be used to control. Used in a control house to provide battery backup in case there's any type of a blackout issue. It's going to give us our control power back to where we can control any type of devices within the substation to make it safe, to keep it from burning up. All right, maintenance on these batteries is important. Okay, it's just a battery, but maintenance on these batteries is important. All right, you could have problems if this isn't proper ventilation. Okay, deterioration with connections and leakages. All right, leakages within the cell, variation in voltage between cell to cell if maintenance isn't done like it's supposed to. Battery charge settings is also an issue you could come up with. And of course, cell post damage is another one. Corrosion, excessive corrosion within that battery. Two types of tests I do want to kind of touch on as far as a performance test and a qualification type test. All right, so performance testing is going to provide the information about the present condition of the battery, such as working voltage and capacity itself. Your qualification type test is going to be done to ensure the capacity of the battery is sufficient and it does meet those system requirements like it's supposed to. All right. Different types of maintenance tests is going to be your visual inspection, checking, and restoring any type of electrolyte values within that cell itself as far as levels are concerned. Measuring individual cell specific gravity, temperature, and of course voltage readings. Cleaning and retorquing those connections is also critical when it comes to batteries as well, keeping in mind that we want to make sure we pay attention to inch pounds instead of foot pounds when it comes to torquing with batteries. A little bit more on batteries as far as testing is concerned, I kind of want to touch on a little bit. So Some of the more conventional methods of testing with batteries is going to be your visual, obviously your visual inspection with batteries, looking for leaks, looking for the obvious buildup in the bottom of the cell, corrosion, if any, hopefully not. Looking at your framework and making sure that that it's not corroded as well. All your connections is key. Float voltage is good. Specific gravity measurement, as far as the gravity or the health of the battery, is something to check. Charging and discharging tests, temperature testing, making sure that the life of the battery is going to be met. Life of the battery reduces with the increase in temperature. Okay, keep that in mind. We want to make sure we keep our rooms at a steady 77 degrees internally. Thermal imaging is another one for finding a good method for finding hot spots within the cell, okay, which can cause high thermal stress, obviously. Impedance testing, all right. And, of course, state of charge, or how much charge is left, how much energy is left within that system, and state of health, all right. Its ability to deliver current when required to supply when it's needed. Capacitor banks, kind of touch on just a little bit about capacitor banks, are used to control the level of voltage supplied to the customer by reducing or eliminating the voltage drop in the system caused by inductive reactive loads. Could or could not see these type of banks in your substations, but if you do, there they are. All right, kind of touch on terminations a little bit here. Before we get into transitional structures, okay? The question is, which pole needs to be used here, okay? We've got, we'll get into the pole as far as transition or transitions are concerned. Potheads, dead front, and live front type systems are three that you could see out there, all right? The one on this far left over here is considered the pothead type of termination. Okay, you can see this little transition here is the actual head where we've got a set of bunched up cables that are going to come up this riser, all right, mounted on the side of the pole. Could be a piece of conduit or just a cover over for the multi-conductor cable to transition from weather protected to exposed. You can see the terminations on the top of that pole right there. What we've got here is we've got a bunched up group of conductors going from a multi-conductor to maybe a single overhead ACSR or something like that. Down on the bottom here is an example of a dead front type system as far as your termination is concerned. This is a totally shielded termination. It provides a high level of protection from moisture and contaminations. This is a load brake elbow on the left-hand side here, and a dead brake elbow and T-body all involved. Okay, one thing I do want to point out as far as a load brake elbow is concerned is that generally your load brake elbows are going to have a white band around the stress cone itself to signify that it is a load brake elbow, meaning that it can be pulled under load, whereas your dead brakes and T-bodies are going to be bolted directly to your transitional boxes, junction boxes, or your transformers. They're not designed to be pulled under load. Live front being the lastly up there, we've got an example of a cold shrink termination cold shrink type termination kit. They have exposed live conductors, meaning you can physically see the connection between the transition itself from underground to overhead or whatever that termination is connected to, even a piece of equipment, a switch or a transformer, anything like that. But it's considered a live front. You can physically see that connection between point A and point B. They don't provide any type of protection, any more than a dead front type would, but they're definitely a means of terminating. All right, transitional structures, okay, different types of transitional structures to see out there is a concrete wooden steel-type poles. These are our structures on the right-hand side over here. But the question, of course, is to determine what type of poles need to be used, depending on the importance of the load, location, place, the cost of the construction itself, maintenance costs, and keeping profit, obviously, is an element in line as far as overall profit in general. Okay. Wood type, of course, we see those wood types in lines that are going to be under 33 kV type. There is a different type of maintenance element involved with wooden type, treated poles, untreated poles. Most of our treated poles, copper nap, and our creosote type poles won't have too much maintenance involved. Of course, the only issue is birds and animals and critters and so forth that may burrow and cause havoc on our pieces of structures out there. Our concrete type of a pole is costlier than wooden poles, but cheaper than steel poles. Okay, typically using 11,000 type volt systems and above. They are weighty and they are breakable. Okay. Steel type systems are load bearing, all right, and they're a little bit more reliable than steel and concrete type poles in the long run. Those are overhead type transitions. Another one I want to get into is underground. We've got risers and junction boxes. Junction boxes, this one on the bottom down here is a nice little junction box, and it's sitting on top of a fiberglass basement. Okay, some of these J boxes could be sitting on a concrete basement, but either way, basements and basements, a little more reliable, easy to install with this fiberglass type basement. Some of these junction boxes could have fuses on the back of them, could have a one in, one out, one in, three out, one in, four out, doesn't matter. A junction box's sole purpose in life is to provide power from one point to maybe one other one, two other one, three and four, and so forth. So I put this slide up here. I like this slide a lot. I haven't seen too many of these around. It really, what it does is it kind of gives the technician an idea about what type of towers that you could see out there. Now, don't throw bricks at me as far as being 100% all accurate on this, but I do want to say that this could give you a general idea on what may be used out there as far as towers. I want to focus, kind of take a look at this right-hand side over here. We've got a this one all the way back in the back down here on the bottom, this with epoxy arms coming out. It looks like it has epoxy arms on it. For 45 up to 69, okay, skip on past. We've got this nice H-frame beside it, all right, and then we've got our Christmas tree type with 230 to 315, and then this big X-frame up to 735. This little slide, this little shot over here on the right-hand side, on the left-hand side, kind of gives you a little bit more information. It may be a little tough to read it, but I still felt that it was a good enough pick to show what these towers could be capable of. But it breaks down a little bit of voltages for you. It kind of tells you where what the structure is made out of, and just a little bit more detail. But either way, good representation of towers. Importance of one-line diagrams, of course. This is, I could talk for a day about these last three subjects, but I want to make sure that that these one-line diagrams do their best to display this configuration of the components within the substation period, and it needs to be as detailed as possible, all right? For that technician, late Friday night, he comes in, he's got to isolate system, he's got to ground a system, and so forth. We want to make sure that that he is awarded every single opportunity so that he can perform his job safely. Shows abnormal and normal conditions. Okay, detailed abnormal and normal conditions, written in red as far as abnormal is concerned. All right, needs to be able to allow that technician to properly troubleshoot that system without having any question involved in it as well. Depending on the type of the substation could determine how big that one-line diagram really is. You need that thing to be as detailed as possible. Isolating and ground, and grounding, of course, is always going to make sure we show on that one-line diagram where those capabilities are. They need to be able to read it all the way down to the lowest level guy, first-year apprentice. He needs to be able to read that one-line diagram so he can interpret it just in case, because one day he's going to be taking that old crusty spot. And lastly, of course, they need to be updated as much as possible, as often as possible, along with your system out in the field from the substation. All right, down and dirty with testing. Okay. Testing all apparatus within the substation, making sure that our equipment is able to perform at its peak value with no interruptions. Unfortunately, I hate to break this to you, but every piece of equipment, just like humans, as soon as they're born, equipment, as soon as it's built, it begins to deteriorate. Based on different factors, of course, moisture, contamination, temperature, excessive load, faults on these pieces of equipment within the sub will dictate how long this piece of equipment is going to last. So it's our job as technicians to make sure that we test these pieces of equipment as often as possible. So first things first, when it comes to testing, we want to make sure we use manufacturer specifications. Open up that switch gear, open up that panel board, check with your operators, make sure that the paperwork is there for those pieces of equipment, and test to manufacturer specifications as far as voltage, parameters with gaps, and any type of adjustments that need to be made. State and local standards is another one. NEDA, of course, is going to provide different types of testing as far as any piece of equipment that you'd have in your substation. It's going to give you good guidance if you don't have guidance or any type of a standard already built for testing. I like to often refer to NEDA as my go-to as far as parameters is concerned. And now, I do want to point out that NEDA testing, their documents is 2015, and if you'll compare manufacturer specifications when it comes to voltages, sometimes you may not see that the voltages within NEDA aren't always going to line up with the voltages in the manufacturer specifications. So keep that in mind. That's why I put manufacturer specifications first and foremost when it comes to testing. And lastly, I need to make sure I advertise that AVO does offer the best training when it comes to testing specification and equipment. I'm not gonna sidetrack you or anything like that. I'm gonna say that we do offer maintenance and testing here at this company, and we'll provide you the best opportunity for performing maintenance on your equipment to the best of our ability. Substation safety. Okay, first things first, anytime we're doing any type of work out there in the field, make sure if it needs to be de-energized, we need to isolate it, send it to Earth. If we're putting our hands on it, make sure it's safe. Make sure it's safe. Proper work permits and authorization. Make sure that we have the proper clearance. Proper authorities have been notified to make sure that work is going to be able to be completed, and make sure that everyone on the work crew is all on the same page when it comes to work and there's no questions asked. Proper signage at the site. I put this up there last time and I'm going to put it up here again. If I do another substation, I'm probably going to throw it up again. Making sure that we keep the bad guys out and the good guys in. Making sure that these people who don't need to be inside of our subs, because we don't have time to babysit them, let's be honest. Authorized personnel only. Qualified is key here, okay? Necessary testing of equipment. There have been guys out there that have been flashed, that have been NEDA certified testers, so there is still a hazard for potential when it comes to testing of equipment. Make sure you follow NFPA 70 when it comes to any type of testing and when it's testing apparatus or anything like that. So be careful out there. Rated shoes, rated gloves, rated sleeves, rated arc flash gear with our proper arc thermal protective value. We get into flash suits, watches, rings, and shiny things. Keep those at home, fellas. Tools and equipment accountability is another one. Make sure you leave with everything that you came into the substation with. All right? There's nothing in there that needs to stay in over there overnight or you need to find the next year. All right? Make sure you leave with everything that you came in with. And lastly, of course, complacency. To me, I've said it before and I've said it for I don't know how long, but complacency kills. And I want to stress that. Keep an eye on your fellow brother out there. Make sure he's making the right moves so that you and him both can go home at the end of the day with all 10 fingers and all 10 toes and leave that substation running up like it's supposed to with no problems whatsoever. All right, so this is a good one. A little bit on summary as far as what we've talked about the last few minutes. So, of course, we did a small review on the substation webinar before the prior one. I felt that that was a good start. This one here kind of gives us a little bit of a chance to dig a little bit deeper into the next one as far as once we get inside the substation. I briefly talked with you about substation layout and some of the different types of systems that you may see. Now, granted, that's open-ended, and you may see multiple different types of systems. As a matter of fact, you may even see systems that may be bonded together as far as the systems and the layout. We briefly talked about conductors, two different types of aluminum and copper as far as being standard. Switches as well. We talked about surge arrestors, their important roles as far as making sure that the voltage is protected, power is protected. Battery maintenance, I kind of gave you a little bit of information on battery maintenance, some over-the-top type of information when it comes to batteries. AVO does offer a battery maintenance course. It is a four-day course. It's thick and thorough, too, so interested in any type of battery maintenance, come check us out. Capacitor banks, what their role is as far as capacitors in the substation. Transitions, terminations. We've talked a little bit about the importance of one-line diagrams and how to interpret those diagrams and how important that is key with one-lines. Down and dirty with testing. I kind of gave you three little points as far as down and dirty with testing and what type of resources that you could come with. Keep that in the back of your mind. Testing is important for equipment reliability, all right? And, of course, lastly, safety. Talked a little bit about safety. Like I said, I'll always talk about safety. I think safety is important. Remember, complacency is key.
Okay, thank you, Greg. Now, just for a quick recap of some substation-related courses that we have, AVO Training offers a Substation Maintenance 1 course, which is a 4.5-day course. And it gives you 3.6 CEU. Substation Maintenance 2 course, which is a 4.5-day course as well. Power Factor Testing course, which is a 3-day course. Transformer Maintenance Testing and Advanced Transformer Maintenance Testing, which are both 4.5-day courses. And then a Battery Maintenance and Testing course, which is a 4-day course. Also, save the date for our next webinar, which will be on April the 17th. From 1 to 2 p.m. Central Standard Time. The title will be A Technician's Approach to Phase and Ground Directional Overcurrent Relaying, presented by Dennis Moon, an AVO training specialist. At this time, the webinar is officially concluded. We will now take the remaining time to answer any questions you may have. If you have any questions, please submit them now in the Q&A box. A recording of this session and a copy of the presentation slides will be available on our website at avotraining.com/webinars. Now let's get to your questions. First question, which comes from Deborah, are polymer insulators good for cold climates like Minnesota winters?
That's a good question. I think that you're right. I lived in North Dakota for 4 years, okay, and I know that for a fact that that your type of climate is going to be similar to our type of climate that we had. Of course, the temperature got down to negative 70 degrees at one time in our life up there in North Dakota. We had more glass insulators up there. I'm sorry, porcelain insulators than anything else. We tried to stay away from as much overhead as possible because of that weather. It plays havoc on that outside poles. Now, granted, the issue that you come up with as far as outside lines on or underground lines in those colder climates is the frost line. Of course, there's not a lot of maintenance that's going to be able to get done with those underground lines because the ground freezes, that moisture freezes, and then you're at almost like a work stoppage till everything thaws out. So.
Okay, next question comes from Rashab. Question is, are they connected in parallel or series? I think this was in reference to a much earlier question, actually, that we that you had in there. I can't remember if you were talking about transistors or insulators, but his question was, are they connected in parallel? So we can go back through that later and find that one.
Okay.
And then we'll send an email about with the answers for all of these questions.
Yeah, definitely. I do want to point out one thing real quick that if you don't get an answer to your question, I do make a special point to sit down, and if it takes me a week to find out, answer everybody's question, I will. But I do get back with you, and I will get back to you 100% if there's any questions that are on there that I don't get a chance to get to.
Okay, next question was from Nadeem. What's the difference between a surge arrestor and a lightning arrestor?
A surge arrestor and a lightning arrestor. Okay, your lightning arrestors, okay, I refer to a surge arrestor. Of course, your lightning arrestor and your surge arrestor is both their job is to accept those transient high voltages and send them to ground. My lightning arrestor idea is going to be that for lightning protection type system, it's going to be a solid copper conductor, and its job is to accept that lightning bolt and send it through and around those buildings straight to a ground grid that encompasses the outside of that facility. With your surge arrestors, there will generally be a resistor that's involved with that surge arrestor that's going to be able to reroute that power and send it to ground before it goes through that equipment itself.
Got next question is, how does a capacitor bank work?
All right. That's a good question. I'll tell you what, who wrote that
Seth.
One? Seth. That's a little bit out of our scope this week as far as the webinar is concerned. Let me get back with you, and I'll put it down to you into what I like to call the trench method of teaching. All right, the down and dirty, simple and easy to understand, not a lot of theory involved or anything like that.
Okay, our next question is from Ahmed. For oil CBs and oil transformers, when to use 877 and 1816?
Okay, that's a good question. Down and dirty for you, this is as simple as it gets. 877 and 1816 are both ASTM standards. And those different standards are going to dictate by how much voltage that particular piece of equipment is able to. The magic number is 230 kV.
Okay, next question is, which interrupter is better in the point of view for maintenance and life or death breaker?
Which interrupter is better for maintenance when it comes to life or death for an interrupter breaker? Okay. Well, that's a good question. I'll kind of touch on that one just a little bit. I can go neck deep into this one probably for a while as far as the interrupter is concerned, but each one of your interrupters are going to have different interrupter abilities as far as cycles, current operation cycles is what I'm talking about. Your interrupters are obviously all going to work differently. They're all going to have different maintenance levels attached to them. SF6 seems to be the new up-and-coming system that's a little more reliable than normal, than regular. Obviously, your OCBs are getting phased out, a little more higher maintenance with your OCBs. I personally like the vacuum type breakers. Those are most near and dear to my heart. I like the way that the functionality of that vacuum breaker works. Its ease of maintenance is easy. It's when it goes, it goes. It's simple, and it's as least complex as possible.
Our next question is, what's the best way to clean a polymer insulator?
Best way to clean a polymer insulator? Denatured alcohol. I'd get up there with something clean, something that doesn't leave a filmy oil, OIL oil. You can get up there and clean it, hit it with some deionized water. There's special type of coatings to put on the insulators. It slipped my mind on the name of the coating as far as coating those insulators for contaminations. I'm going to get back to you on that question there as far as a contamination coating or coating the insulator or the insulator and the insulator as far as keeping contaminants away from it. Lost my mind on that one.
Our next question comes from John. Are there any precautions needed in installing aluminum wire over copper? As an owner, we prefer copper, but accept aluminum as a value engineering offering.
Is there any precautions as far as installing
aluminum wiring over copper?
Aluminum, you're talking about, I want to say he's talking about the,
the aluminum conductors.
Okay, so I want to think that he's talking about preferences in reference to as far as copper over aluminum. Obviously, aluminum is going to be a whole lot lighter. Aluminum is going to be a little cheaper than copper. Copper's conductivity is going to be a little better than aluminum. Okay, but there's different types of applications. Obviously, underground, overhead. I'd have to kind of sit down with you and find out exactly what type of application we're getting into: multi-conductor, single conductor, what type of insulation. It's kind of a tough one. Maybe go ahead and add another question to that one there to Larry. I guess that's what his name is.
John.
Okay, and go ahead and put a little bit more meat on that question. I'll do my best to try to get back with you on that one.
What's the SOP for checking voltage present on a fence before entering a substation?
What's the standard operating procedures for checking voltage on a fence? Okay. Well, that's a good question. I have been asked that question before. That's a good one. You picked a good one, Mike. As far as checking for voltage on a fence, you really don't have anything other than ground to refer to as far as testing for voltage. I'll tell you what, I find that question is going to be, I'm going to need to go on IEEE and see what the IEEE standard may say, if anything, about the need for testing for voltage on a fence. Because that's the whole purpose behind that grounding grid, is to dissipate any type of current that may be induced on that grid. So I'm going to look into that one and see if there's any SOPs that may be needed to refer to when testing your substation fences. Good question, though. Real good question.
Okay, next question is from Lee. What's the safety of spray painting or sandblasting inside the substation per insulators or any equipment inside the station?
The safety involved with that? Well, first of all, obviously, you want to make sure that that issue is tried to be de-energized as much as possible. I've never gone into a substation and sandblast or sprayed or blasted any substation insulators out there. We've always gone in and physically wiped down our piece of equipment and perform maintenance on our insulators to clean them up of any type of contaminations or anything like that. So let me get back with you on that one and find out. I don't mind saying, hey, I've never done that before. If you've got a question like that and I'm not familiar with it, I'll definitely get back with you and check with you and find out what the safety behind that would be. So let me get back with you on that, boss man.
Okay. Looks like we have about a time for about one more question. So our final question and all the rest of the questions that we have will be answered and emailed out to everyone. But our final question for now will be, are the conductors used for lightning diversion bare or insulated?
For lightning diversion. Lightning diversion. Okay, so that's you're dipping into lightning protection systems. And so, you know, that's a good question. I'm glad you picked that question all the way out the door, Mike. So that's a good question because that was a subject that I had originally and initially put on this webinar as far as information within a substation, because I feel like lightning protection systems sometimes get overlooked. First and foremost, if you're interested, that NFPA 780 is the reference when it comes to lightning protection systems. So keep that in mind as far as the reference is concerned within substations. So, but as far as conductors, clearly there's going to be different types of methods for lightning protection system, our catenary system, rolling ball method, of course, is a way to measure that cat system, our single pin type method. They're all solid conductors. Everything's referenced to ground. Solid meaning, let me back up, open air conductors. Could be a solid conductor, or it could be a stranded type of conductor that's going to go ultimately at the end of the day to a Cadwell connection within the earth that's going to be connected to the system. NFPA 70 is a good reference for that type of question, though. Good question.
Okay, it looks like that's all the time we have for now. We apologize if we did not get to your question today. We will email you the answers to your questions we didn't get a chance to answer. Remember, you can view all of our entire webinar schedule and see all of our previous webinars at avotraining.com/resources/webinars. We hope to see you again at our next webinar, and thank you again.